Hello everyone, welcome back. So now we are going to start with a series of videos regarding various diseases of pulp, because now if you know the disease, then only you can give the treatment. Hence it is very important to know each and every disease properly and in detail. So this is the first part of your series, and in this we are going to cover about the causes, like why exactly the pulp disease is caused, and also we are going to see about the cracked tooth syndrome. There's this famous quote which is given by Sir William Osler. So he says that listen to your patients, the patient will give you the diagnosis. So it means that the patient, they tell you all the symptoms, and through that symptoms you will get the diagnosis itself through the patient only. Now for this you should know the disease well. Like for example, if the patient is coming to your clinic and he's saying, I am having severe toothache at the night time, and because of that toothache I cannot sleep. Now if you know which disease exactly have this symptom, so you got the diagnosis through the patient itself. So this, the answer, like the diagnosis for the symptom is your irreversible pulpitis. Now you know the diagnosis, so the treatment also, it becomes easy. So in this, first thing that you should know is about the disease. You should know everything about the disease, and then only you can diagnose it well. So in this videos, in the series of videos, we are going to see each and every diseases of the pulp and the periradicular space. So starting first with the causes, like why exactly a pulpal disease is caused. So there are three main reasons for them, that is physical, chemical or bacterial. Now in physical, it is again divided into two, that can be a mechanical or thermal. So from this, like any of this reason can cause pulpal disease. So the first causes are your physical causes. Now in this physical causes, it is again divided into, that is mechanical and thermal. So mechanical, they are usually due to trauma or pathologic wear of the teeth. So mechanical is trauma or pathologic wear, or there are some more reasons. So trauma, now in this trauma, it can be due to fracture or avulsion of the teeth. So acute trauma, like, now it is not always compulsory that the patient is having fracture. So it may or it may not be accompanied by the fracture of the crown or the root. So it can be like due to fight during like playing. So it can be at the time of playing sports, or it can be due to accident. So the patient is having trauma at any of this time, or if the patient is having habits such as opening the bobby pins with the help of teeth, so that can also cause the trauma to the tooth, and because of that there can be the pulpal disease. Or if the patient is having the habit of nail biting, so all this type of trauma, it can cause the pulpal injury. Now the next cause is your pathologic wear from either adhesion, abrasion, bruxism or effraction. Now in addition to certain dental procedure, it can also injure the pulp. Now for example, if you are doing some dental procedures, so that can also cause like injury to your pulp. So that can be like the injury is caused at the time of excavation of the caries, or because of too rapid movement of the tooth at the time of orthodontic treatment. So all that can also cause the pulpal disease. Now next come is your cracked tooth syndrome. Now in this mechanical only you have cracked tooth syndrome. So about this cracked tooth syndrome, we are going to see in the later part of this video, because now this is a very commonly asked question. And the next etiological factor in your mechanical causes will be your periodontalgia. Now periodontalgia, it is nothing but it is a pain in the tooth due to the changes in the barometric pressure. Now this periodontalgia, it is also known as aerodontalgia, which denotes that the patient is having toothache which is occurring at a low atmospheric pressure, which is experienced either during the flight or during the test run in the decompression chamber. Now it is observed in the altitude which is over 5000 feet. So periodontalgia is nothing but the patient is having toothache due to the pressure changes, due to the changes in your atmospheric pressure. So these are the mechanical causes of your physical causes. Now the next one are your thermal. So the thermal, the first one will be the heat which is generated by the cutting procedure. So it is basically at the time of excavation of the caries or at the time of cavity preparation. So now the cavity preparation, it proceeds with the like you are like doing the preparation of the cavity. So because of that, what can happen is it is going to produce some temperature changes which can cause irreparable pulp damage. Hence caries is removed. So how can you prevent it? So because of that only, we are removing the caries in increments. That is, we lift the air rotor in between and between. It's not like we are continuously placing the air rotor on the tooth, because of that it can lead to damage to your pulp. Or the next will be you are using the water spray. So this is the main reason, like why our air rotors are having those water spray jet, because that water spray is acting as a coolant. So this is the next reason. So the heat which is generated by the cutting procedure can damage your pulp. The next one is the heat from the restorative material. So that is the heat which is conducted by the fillings. Now in this, the metallic fillings which are close to the pulp without an cement base, that can conduct temperature changes and which will lead to the irreversible changes of the pulp, damaging the pulp. So now the restorative material. So now if you know you are preparing the cavity and you are going to place a metallic restoration. So you know that we are going to place a base and then only we are going to place the restoration. If you are directly placing the restoration on the prepared cavity, so because of that there can be the chances of the pulp damage. The next one is the heat which is generated from some electrosurgical procedures. And the next reason can be the heat which is generated at the time of polishing of the restoration. Now this is due to the functional heat. So this is due to the frictional heat during the polishing. Now in this, enough heat, it may be generated during the polishing of a filling or during the setting of the cement. So these all are the reasons that are your physical causes of the pulpal disease. The next are your chemical causes. So chemical causes will be the acids from erosion, or if you are using some chemicals like monomer, liner, bases, phosphoric acid, or the use of cavity desiccants like alcohol. So any of this, so basically they have all the chemicals. So this chemicals also can cause pulpal disease, but the chemical cause of the pulp injury is probably the least common. Now the last causes are your bacterial causes. So in 1894, W.D. Miller, he suggested that bacteria were a possible cause of inflammation in the pulp, and the most common cause of the pulp injury is bacteria. So bacteria or their products, it may enter the pulp through a break in the dentine. So that break in the dentine, it can be because of caries, or it can be the accidental exposure, or because of fracture, or if there is percolation around the restoration, so because of that also the bacteria, it can enter your pulp, or if there is extension of the infection from the gingival sulcus, or if there is periodontal pocket and abscess, so basically it has this endoperio lesion, or it can be the process by which the microorganisms get carried by the bloodstream from another source and they localized on the inflamed tissue, which is known as anachoresis. So these are the various like reasons in which the bacteria, it reaches into the pulp and which can cause the pulpal damage. So those were the causes of the pulpal disease. Now starting with the diseases, so the first one is your cracked tooth syndrome. Now the name says cracked tooth syndrome. So the tooth, it is having a crack. So it is described as an incomplete fracture of a vital tooth. So this fracture line, it can involve enamel and dentine and possibly the dental pulp. So basically your cracked tooth syndrome is nothing but the tooth is having an incomplete fracture like a crack. So it may cause a complete fracture reaching the dental pulp and or periodontal ligament. So in this case, it's not always that the patient is having, so in this cracked tooth syndrome, the patient is having the fracture till the pulp. It may be limited to the enamel and dentine also. So the term cracked tooth syndrome, it was first used by Dr. Cameron in 1964. So in this, molars of the older individuals, they are most commonly involved in this cracked tooth syndrome. So the mandibular molar, they are most commonly affected, followed by the maxillary molar, and next are your maxillary premolar. So in this, the tooth which is most commonly affected by this cracked tooth syndrome is your mandibular molar, because now in this there's the highest amount of masticatory forces which are applied, and that can lead to the cracked tooth syndrome. So the various etiological factor for your cracked tooth syndrome can be if there is sudden and excessive biting force, or if there is a large untreated caries lesion which is left. if the patient is having the habit of bruxism or clenching. So all this can cause this cracked tooth syndrome. The next can be if you are preparing the cavity excessively. So that can also cause this cracked tooth syndrome. The next can be if there is stress concentration of the tooth. Like if you are placing the amalgam pins in a tooth. So that can also lead to this cracked tooth syndrome. The next causes can be if there are any enamel cracks. If you're using dental instrument, that is nothing but the cracking and the creasing, which is associated with the high speed handpieces. So all this can lead to the cracked tooth syndrome. Now this cracked tooth syndrome, it is classified into 5 types. That can be your crease lines. So over here now you can see, so these are your crease lines. So these are nothing but the lines which are present on the tooth. The next can be a cracked tooth. So in this, the tooth is only cracked. Now over here you can see, so the tooth is only cracked. The next type is the fractured cusp. So in this, the cusp is fractured. The next type is a split tooth. Now over here you can see the tooth is splitted into two. And the next type is the vertical root fracture. Over here now you can see. So there is this vertical root fracture. So these are the various types of the cracked tooth syndrome. Now what are the symptoms of the cracked tooth syndrome? So in this, the patient is going to complain of the pain. So the pain, it can be mild to severe, and the pain, it is usually encountered at the time of initiation or the release of the biting pressure. So if the patient is going to bite, or if he is going to release that biting pressure, so at that time only the patient is going to feel that pain. So it is because of that cracked tooth syndrome. Now in this, such teeth, they are sensitive for years because of an incomplete fracture. Now we have seen the cracked tooth syndrome, it is an incomplete fracture. So because of that, the teeth which is having this cracked tooth syndrome, they are sensitive and they will produce only mild pain. So after that, the pain, it becomes severe when the fracture is going to involve the pulp. So as if the patient is like going to keep this tooth untreated. So after that, the fracture line, it will involve the pulp chamber also, and that time the pain will become severe. Now in this case, the pulp of the teeth, they become necrotic. Now the clinical feature is you're going to do the close examination of the crown of the tooth, and it may disclose an enamel crack. So by this, you're going to like know that it is a cracked tooth syndrome. Now how are you going to diagnose the cracked tooth syndrome? So there are two like ways in which you can diagnose it. So there are the simple tools for diagnosis, or there are the sophisticated tools. So the first type of diagnosis will be you're going to percuss the tooth. So if the patient is having mild pain, or whenever you're percussing the tooth, so at that time you'll see the patient is having that mild pain. So this is the first diagnosis, like one way of diagnosing the cracked tooth syndrome, but this is not that relevant. The next one is the careful probing with the help of an explorer. The next is the biting on the tooth slot. Now what is this? Now this is a very important like main diagnosis, simple tool of diagnosis for your cracked tooth syndrome. So this is how your tooth slot, it looks like. So basically it is a small pyramidal shaped plastic bite block which is having a concavity at the apex of the pyramid. So now what you're going to do is you're going to place this like indentation over the cusp, and the patient is asked to bite. So thus the occlusal forces, they are directed to one cusp at a time, exerting the desired pressure on the questionable cusp. So over here now you can see, so this is how the patient, so this is like the indentation. So this indentation, it is kept on the like tooth or the cusp which is in the question. So because of this, the patient is asked to bite, and because of this, the occlusal forces, they are directed at one cusp at a time. The next type of diagnosis will be biting on a cotton applicator or a rubber wheel. The next is you're going to isolate with a rubber dam, and the next are your micro photographs. So with the help of this photograph, you will see that there are these cracks which are present on the tooth. The next are your sophisticated tools. So these are like a more better like way of diagnosing the cracked tooth syndrome. So one can be the dye. So in this, what you're going to do is you're going to stain the fracture with a dye which is known as methylene blue, and it is a very valuable aid to detect a fracture. So over here now you can see, so this is the methylene blue. So when you're going to stain this, so you can see this fracture line properly. The next way of diagnosing is using the fibro optic light. Now in this, this is used to transilluminate a fracture line. So most cracks, they run mesiodistally, and they are rarely detected radiographically when they are incomplete. Now over here you can see, so this is the light which you are going to pass through the tooth. Now you can see over here, so this is the fracture line which is passing mesiodistally. And the next are your CBCT. So these are the various tools of diagnosis for your cracked tooth syndrome. And lastly is, how are you going to treat the cracked tooth syndrome? So in this, the therapy will be the immediate therapy and the final therapy. So immediate is, in this, the primary goal, it should be to splint and to stabilize a cracked tooth immediately. And final therapy, it forms in the terms of functions and aesthetic. So the cracked tooth, it is managed by immediate reduction of the occlusal contact by selective grinding. So what you're going to do is, you're going to grind the tooth by selective grinding so that the occlusal contact, they are like, so it is like de-occluded. So this is the first thing that you're going to do. The next is removal of the intracoronal restoration in a suspected tooth, and it may reveal a crack in the enamel which is running into the dentine. So if there's a restoration which is placed in the tooth, so what you're going to do is, if you think that this tooth is having a cracked tooth syndrome, so you're going to remove that restoration. So the next is, if the patient has incomplete fracture of only enamel and dentine, so you can place a full crown restoration which can immobilize the segment, and that can be a successful treatment plan for such tooth which is having an incomplete fracture. Then definite treatment, it attempts to preserve the pulpal vitality by requiring a full occlusal coverage for the cusp protection. The basic aim is, if the patient is having this incomplete fracture, so the basic aim will be, you need to preserve the pulp vitality. So that pulp vitality, it can be preserved by, you're going to do the full crown restoration. The next is, when the aging defect, it encroaches on the pulp, emerging endodontic symptoms, it is consistent with the irreversible pulpitis. They are inductive, and that will lead to the treatment plan of your root canal treatment. So this is the basic chart of your cracked tooth syndrome, the treatment for the cracked tooth syndrome. So over here, now you're going to assess the tooth, whether it is having a small peripheral crack or if it is having a large central crack. Now, if the patient is having only a small peripheral crack, so in that, you're going to remove that compromised portion, and then you're going to restore it with the composite or pin retained amalgam or cast restoration, whatever it is. If now the patient is having, so this is your tooth. So if the patient is having a large central crack, so in that case, now first you're going to see if the pulp is involved or if the pulp is not involved, or if it is having a hopeless prognosis. So if it is having a hopeless prognosis, that is, if it is having a vertical crack, if the tooth is having a vertical crack, so in that case, it becomes a hopeless prognosis. So in that case, you need to extract the tooth. So you're going to see for that, if it is having hopeless prognosis, or if the pulp is involved, or if the pulp is not involved. So if now you see the pulp is not involved, so in that, you're going to stabilize the tooth with the orthodontic band. Then you're going to do the occlusal adjustment. As I said, that you're going to de-occlude the tooth. Then you're going to give the permanent stabilization, and then you're going to give a cast restoration material or the bonded restoration, whatever it is. Now, if you see that the pulp is involved, so in that, again, you're going to do the immediate stabilization, and then you're going to do the pulpal extirpation. That is, you're going to remove whatever that pulp is. That is your root canal treatment. And then you're going to monitor for the symptoms, and then you're going to complete your endodontic treatment. And after you have completed your endodontic treatment, again, you're going to do the permanent stabilization. And lastly, you're going to give that restoration. That can be a bonded restoration or a cast metal restoration. So this is the basic chart for your treatment of the cracked tooth syndrome. So that was all about the first part of this disease of the pulp, in which we have seen majorly about the causes and the cracked tooth syndrome. Now, in the next part, we are going to see about the pulpitis, that is the reversible pulpitis and the irreversible pulpitis. So that was all about it. I hope you found this video helpful. And if you did, then please comment, share, and do subscribe to my channel. Thank you so much.